All right, easy. What's this one? Downy woodpecker. How do we know it's a downy and not the hairy woodpecker? The size. Right, of course, the size. All right, what is it? It's the size of the beak, yes. The downies have a bill that is only about one half the width of the head, as compared to the hairy woodpecker, which has a bill about one full width of the head. So this proves it, that size does matter, okay? Here's, oh, you guys didn't go for that joke at all. These are the males, they have the red spot, okay? And the females don't, all right? So now, and you guys know, here's my ringer. There's my ringer, and there's the other one. I got two ringers in here. So what's the, let me back up. Downy and hairy woodpeckers have identical plumage, except for one thing. What is it? Ooh, another ringer. What, do you know this? Tail spots. Yeah, here they are. Right there and there. So that proves that there's four people in this room who are really sick. Okay? So there's the tail spots. The downies have it and the hairies do not. Woodpeckers are an amazing, amazing group of birds. I love them. In fact, I love them so much, I did a book on them. Come see me afterwards, okay? But they're highly specialized birds. They're so specialized that they have feet that are unlike any other bird. Most birds have three toes forward and one toe pointing back. Woodpeckers have two toes forward and two toes back. This is called a zygodactyl arrangement. They have one toe that will actually switch back and forth. It gives them one extra toe on the downward side. Okay, so they fly up to something and they grab a hold. And gravity's pulling on them, so they need an extra toe on the bottom to help hold them up. Which, by the way, I'm absolutely convinced that every person in this room takes the action of a woodpecker flying up and clinging to the side of a tree totally for granted. Think about it. How do other birds land on a branch? On the top, because of gravity. What do woodpeckers do? They fly over and they literally go like Velcro. How do they do that? Do you ever see them go like this? Do you? You don't. These birds are like, tink, and they're there. It's truly amazing. I mean, last time I checked, gravity's working for birds, too. And yet, they're doing it. It's amazing. They also have incredibly stiff tail feathers. These tail feathers are the third leg of the tripod. So they got one leg, the other leg, and they need a third one. Otherwise, it's like, it doesn't work. So the tail feathers are extremely stiff. Have you ever sat and listened to a woodpecker fly? Tell me I'm the only one. Really? Come on. You guys, how are you going to be a good naturalist if you don't listen to woodpeckers fly? They sound like they got balsa wood wings. Clack, 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 clack. Mark my words. The next time you're out there in your backyard and your downy woodpecker flies by, you're going to go, damn, that Stan was right. Because you're going to hear it. That's how stiff these feathers are. They literally clack together. That's how hard they are. And they have to be, because they're going inside of cavities, outside of cavities, and they're wearing down their feathers. Okay? They also have amazing tongues. They have tongues that start at the beginning of the bill. They work back through the oral pharynx. They actually exit the skull. They go around the back of the top of the skull, and they come back, and in this case, which is the northern flicker, attaches in the right nostril. Wow, that's a tongue. Why? Why do they have such big tongues? Anybody know? Well, one theory is that they think it helps to protect their brain. Well, look, if it's your job to get up every morning and go out and bang holes in trees with your face, you're going to come up with some way to not come home with brain damage every night, right? And so it's figured that these guys, they have this extra long tongue that helps just cushion the impact when they're hitting those trees. And that's one more thing we're taking for granted with these woodpeckers. Go out and try getting a hole in a tree, okay? Do it. Go out there. No pocket knife, no nothing. You go out and do it, all right? You superior humans, go ahead, you know? It's crazy. We take this all for granted with these birds, too. What's this one here? Red-bellied woodpecker. Really? 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 Red-bellied woodpecker? Who named these things, okay? So this bird was named in the 1850s by the shotgun method. You know this method, right? Guys in the 1850s, some like Audubon. Everybody hear of Audubon? You guys ever hear this guy? John something Audubon. He'd go out with a shotgun. He'd see a bird he didn't know. Blast it out of a tree. This is the shotgun method. You can just see this happening. Red-belly woodpecker shoots it, picks it up. Huh. It's got a red belly. We'll call it red-belly woodpecker. And then here we are, you know, 170 years later with our binoculars going, I don't get it. Why do they call it red-belly woodpecker? Well, apparently it's got a red wash between its legs. But you never see it, of course. Who's got this coming to their feeders? Anybody? Oh, most of you should, right? This is a bird that's showing up at just about everybody's feeders. 10 years ago, you didn't have this bird. This is a new bird. It's expanding all over the place. It's just showing up everywhere. All right. This is the male. He's got red all the way down. Okay. Here's the female. She's gray on the top. Because remember, in the bird world, it's the boys who dress up, not the girls. Okay. But it's truly, it's an amazing success story. This bird is going everywhere. They are a primary cavity nester, meaning they make their own cavity and they nest in it. One time only, then they move on to another one, and they'll make another new home, all right? What's this one here? Somebody mentioned it earlier. It's worth noting. Red-headed woodpecker. Who's got this coming to their feeders? Yeah, nobody. Anybody raising their hand? One person. Yeah. Look.
I misspoke. It was a
pileated. Ah, well, too bad you didn't have redheads, because these guys are amazing. Okay, 1850, that crazy guy, John James Audubon, says that this woodpecker is the most numerous woodpecker in North America. He called it semi-domesticated. He actually called it a camp robber. He called it a pest. What's our most numerous woodpecker now? The downy is our most numerous woodpecker. So what's happened here? You guys hear of this little thing called the CBC, Christmas Bird Count? You guys know this? Yeah. Audubon started it, right? 1900 it started, because people used to go out and just shoot birds, just see how many birds they could shoot in one day. Audubon convinced them to stop shooting the birds and just count the birds on that day. So in a two-week period around Christmas, people go out all over the nation and they count birds. Not, I saw a blue jay, it's how many blue jays, how many redhead woodpeckers. We have a data set from 1900 to the year 2011. When you look at red-headed woodpeckers, from 1900 to 1950, there's no change. From 1950 to the year 2000, 80% of these birds go away. 80. We're losing this bird at the rate of about 4 to 5% per year. I don't think it'd be a stretch to say this bird could go away in that young man's lifetime. At that rate, it's going away quickly. I know of areas, I've been leading birding trips for almost 30 years, and I know places I used to bring people to see redhead woodpeckers, they're no longer there. Populations are dropping like a rock. Why? Habitat loss? Is it really? Is it really? Check it out. Really? Primary cavity nester, right? It's a primary cavity nester. These guys are doing great. They nest in approximately the same types of things as this. So really, is it habitat loss?
Pesticides.
Is it pesticides? What do these birds eat? The primary food for them is acorns. They're mostly seed eaters. The answer is, nobody knows. The answer is, this bird's going away. There's this huge, giant red flag going back and forth. And nobody's paying attention. This is truly an issue. It really is. This should be a shame to see this bird go away. And it will, too.
A lot of species are going away, unfortunately.
Not at this rate, though.
Not at this rate?
No. We are losing other things. Purple martins are one. Meadowlarks are another. Go ahead.
I think we need to give some credit to our friends across the river in the Audubon chapter of Minneapolis. I'm sure you're aware of the program of this, but Redheaded Woodpecker Recovery Project.
They are. They're starting a redheaded recovery project through Minneapolis Audubon. You should check them out. It's well worth it. Go ahead.
I have those up on my campus, and I wondered what I could do to improve their chances. Nothing?
They're a cavity nester. They make their own nest. They won't use a box. So, you know, what do you do? Yeah, grow an oak savanna is the answer. How about this one here? This is a yellow-bellied sapsucker. First and foremost, holy mackerel, there really is a bird named yellow-bellied sapsucker. Apparently it has a yellow belly, but sucks sap. Do you see any lips on this bird? Come on, really, you know? Turns out, what do? They drill holes in trees like this. Out from those holes come out the sap, and they take a modified tongue that has little hairs on it, like here. These hairs are like a paintbrush, and then they put their tongue in there, and they lap up the sap. So it should be called what? Yeah, yellow-bellied sap lapper, of course. Okay. Here is your pileated woodpecker, 18 inches tall, fabulous bird. Here's the male. He's got a red mustache, red forehead. Here's the female, black mustache, black forehead. And what's really cool about these birds is that when they leave the nest, when these babies leave the nest, they are fully feathered and look exactly like adults, and they sound exactly like adults, too, when they come out of the nest. So it's one of those things where you can't ever see the young ones. And look at the tongue on these guys, huh? Crazy stuff. We're gonna skip over this guy here. We'll go right to this one. What's this one here? Osprey. Simple question. You guys should know this. Is this a type of hawk or is this a type of eagle?
Neither.
Nice. The answer over here was neither. They're an osprey. They're in their own family. They're not a hawk. They're not an eagle. They're an osprey. They're very unique in that they dive into the water, plunge into the water, feet first, grabbing fish. No other bird does this like that, okay? And this bird was extirpated from Minnesota. Can I say that in public? That sounds like a naughty word, doesn't it? Extirpated, what does it mean? Locally extinct, wiped out. This bird was wiped out in Minnesota and reintroduced in the 1980s and is now doing excellent. But when it was first reintroduced, there were some really interesting things going on. In the fall, these birds would leave, and we didn't know where they went to. So they put little radio backpacks on it. This occurred in the early 1980s, right by my house, about 3 miles from my house. I had front row seats on this. It was awesome to watch. So these birds would leave in the fall, and it'd be really cool because the female, she'd leave Minnesota, go down to Florida. From Florida, she'd go over to Cuba. From Cuba, she'd go over to the Yucatan Peninsula of Mexico, spend her winter there. The male would leave, go over to Texas, down through Mexico, through Central America, down to South America. He'd spend his winters down there. In the spring, they turn around, and they come back up, and they meet back up at the nest. I'm immediately thinking these birds are onto something. You know, separate vacations, thousands of miles apart from each other in the tropics, you know? Okay. And so then this is where we really first started looking at this age-old question about, do these birds mate for life? Do birds mate for life? Do eagles, do swans, do osprey, do these birds mate for life? This is a burning question for a lot of people. Come on, admit it. You want to know this, don't you? You know? And so the answer is this. Ready? The answer is yes, they do, and no, they don't, okay? Yes, they will mate for life, providing certain conditions. A, they're both alive, okay? B, they're successful at mating. So, you got a young pair, they're just starting out, and they try to breed, and nothing works. They oftentimes will divorce, go find somebody else in a new location, and start over again. But a pair who's been at it for a while, mature, know what they're doing, they oftentimes will stick together. And it turns out that the fidelity is not to each other. The fidelity is to the nest. You can see this happening. It's spring. The osprey comes back to the nest. Oh, I missed you. You were this great, wonderful. You look kind of familiar. And there's the mate. Like, really? You look kind of interesting. You look kind of familiar. Because they're doing the same thing. They're coveting the nest. And yet, this is why they go through pair bonding again. And why they go through that whole rituals again, too. This is not so bad, by the way. Okay? And so, it's this really interesting stuff. I'm also the naturalist for the city of Eden Prairie. We had this great pair of osprey. Had this female who was super reproductive. She was there for like 15, 18 years. Every year she would show up. Everything was great. She had this guy. The guy was awesome. He was always there. But the male, always in another park, at another nest site, had a second female. Don't judge him. But it never really worked out. So he was always over here. About 4 years ago, guess who doesn't show up after spring migration? The big female. Does the male sit around the nest, oh, boo-hoo, boo-hoo, poor me? Does he? No. What does he do? He runs over to the girlfriend's place, bada-boom, bada-bing, guess what? They're reproducing. Now they're going on their fourth year of reproducing. They've got babies every single year, and everything's good. So for her, she mated for life, okay? So it's really kind of, you know, pretty cut and dry in the bird world. It truly is. So some pretty amazing things. I can never remember what this thing is. See me afterwards. I got a book on them. Okay, same thing here. You guys interested in eagles? I got an eagle book for you here, too. This is the commercial break here. How about that indigo bunting? Don't you love them? Won't be long. They'll be coming back, right? Here's the male, all dressed up in his blues, right? Looking good. By the way, this is the female. She's brown. Because remember, in the bird world, boys are dressed up, okay? Except for in the wintertime. So this is a male in the wintertime. This is down in Florida in the wintertime. They don't breed in the wintertime. So really, why dress up if you're not trying to impress, right? I'll do better next time. Oh my gosh, don't get me started on bluebirds. I absolutely love these guys. They're fabulous. Blue jays, related to the crows and the jays. Very smart bird. I love these guys. I don't know why people don't like them. They always say, well, they eat other birds' babies. Well, guess what? Get over it. It's a bird-eat-bird world out there. Everybody's eating everybody else, okay? So just get over it, okay? These guys, and don't get me started on that subject because I can really get going. Okay, they have a sublingual pouch, an under-the-tongue pouch. They can actually put, I've seen them put in like 10 or 12 peanuts in there. And I've seen them put in so many peanuts in that sublingual pouch, they fly like this, you know? And then when it's sticking out like that, we call them the Dolly Parton birds, of course. Okay, let's goof around with you guys. Okay, so what's this one here? Anybody know? House wren. I love this house wren. Okay, I know you probably don't like it, but I love the house wren. Okay, this is my guy. This is my yard. This is my house here. Okay, May 1st, the guy shows up. Right like clockwork. I put up 3 different boxes for him. He loves it. He gets there. What does he do? He goes around to all the boxes. He puts in a dozen or 2 dozen sticks that are all about that long and all about the uniform shape, size. Puts in all these sticks in the nest, you know, goes around to all of them. And then what does he do? He gets up on them and starts to sing, right? I remember one time waking up, 3 o'clock in the morning, springtime thunder shower, you know, sheets of rain, claps of thunder, lightning, everything. Who's out there singing in the middle of the night in the rain? My guy. Talk about driven by your hormones, I'm telling you. He's a slave to his hormones, okay? So, but it's a great bird. And then what happens is if he attracts in a female, he'll take her to the prospective houses. He'll take her to the first house and say, what do you think? And she'll go there and she'll stick her head in, back out, look again, being really critical. I don't know. He'll get all nervous and go, all right, come on over here, you know? And they'll go to the second box, and then she'll go, she'll look inside, and she'll come back. Is this sounding familiar to anybody? You know? And then she decides, of all the choices, which one they're going to nest in. She says, okay, this is the one here. And then she'll fill that box right to the top with sticks, right? In the back, she'll put a nice little nest. She'll line it with some nice plant material, nice soft. She'll start laying her eggs. What does the male do? He starts singing and says, come on down, I got 2 more boxes to go. You know? And if he's successful at getting in a second female, it's the first female's responsibility to chase her off. If she doesn't, he will try to attend to both of them. Don't judge him. Okay? So they started doing a little, about 5 years ago, they started doing a little DNA test, simple, easy DNA test, where they take a look at the offspring of the house wrens. They have about 4, sometimes up to 6 eggs. And they took a look at the offspring on it, took a little DNA sample from each one of them. Turns out 30 to 40% of the offspring were not genetically related to the male. How does that happen? Okay. Let's go back to biology here, okay? Let's go back to those health classes, okay? How does this happen? Turns out the female is listening to the neighboring male going, huh, sounds kind of good. Actually, it sounds kind of hot. And she sneaks off in the middle of the day for a little, you know, afternoon delight, you know? And then comes back as though nothing has happened at all, you know? You talk about your dastardly things. I mean, here she is. This is called extra-pair copulations, where she goes out and solicits copulations from other males just to improve the genes.
Don't judge.
You know? Don't judge. Yeah, but at least you could come up with a better excuse than improving genes, you know? So they started looking around. Guess what? Turns out my beloved bluebirds are doing the same thing, and so are blue jays, and so are cardinals, and so are robins. It turns out a regular patent place out there. Oh, everybody's breeding with everybody else. That's an old fan of patent place over there, right there. She got that. Does anybody even remember patent place? Okay. And so it's just crazy how they do this, and they do this to increase the genetic diversity. This is all happening in our own yards, and we don't even know it. It's like, wow, right there in front of us. Truly amazing stuff. Last bird, okay? We'll wrap it up in here, all right? What's this here? American kestrel. Fabulous bird. It's a type of falcon, and they recently discovered about 12 years ago that this bird has an extra cone in its eye, allows it to see in ultraviolet light. That's pretty darn amazing. You're probably thinking, really, Stan? Who cares, right? Admit it. That's what you're thinking, right? Here's the male, blue wings or gray wings. Here's the female, brown. But it has an extra cone in the eye. This extra cone, by the way, has an oil droplet in here. That oil droplet helps it to get polarization like polarized sunglasses. I want this, okay? I want polarized sunglasses built into my eyes. I want that, okay? That's a good thing. I would love to have it. And so this is pretty unusual, too. So I'm going to show you a little bit of a video here while I talk about this bird here. So they discovered this and they thought, so what's the implications of this? Why does this bird have it? Well, what does it hunt? It hunts small mammals, oftentimes, like voles, mice, shrews, these types of things. And these small mammals, here's the back of the eye, okay? And this is where they've got these little ultraviolet sensors. By the way, can you see an ultraviolet light? No, you cannot. Ultraviolet light is beyond our spectrum of light that we can see. And these small mammals run along well-defined trails, okay? And they pee, they tinkle, they urinate as they go along. And guess what shows up under the ultraviolet light? But the urine, okay? So here they are. We'll show you a little graphic of this, of how it looks. So there they are moving along through the grass here. And there's the kestrel hovering above. So when you see them along the side of the highway, they're not just sitting there looking down going, gosh, I wonder if something's down there. They're actually looking at, look at the trails of the UV light bouncing off of the urine. And it helps them find these things. So they started saying, well, gosh, if the kestrel has it, do other birds have it? And so you cannot look at all birds. There are 9,000 species of birds. You can't check them all. So what did they do? Right here at the University of Minnesota, they checked 500 birds. Turns out all 500 of them had the extra cone in the eye. What is this about? Why do these birds have this extra cone in their eye? Well, it helps them in many, many different ways. Remember earlier we were talking about the red-headed woodpecker? I forgot to mention, but that's a non-sexually dimorphic bird, meaning you cannot tell the boys from the girls. Even if you had red-headed woodpecker pair in your hands, you cannot tell the boys from the girls. Put them under ultraviolet light, you can. Have you ever wondered, like blue jays? They look the same. How do you tell the boys from the girls? What do? Fly up to each other, lift their tails? Well, it turns out that you put a male blue jay under a light, big white patch on the wing. The birds can see perfectly what is going on. You and I cannot. There is so much going on in nature, even in your own backyard. There are birds with extra pair copulations going on in your yard. There are birds who can see in ultraviolet light in your yard. There are bird species that are crashing right in front of us, the red-headed woodpecker. There are bird species that are soaring in population in our backyards, the red-bellied woodpecker. There is so much going on in nature. We as people think we're pretty darn smart. We think we've got this figured out. We can handle nature. We can manage nature. If I hear that one more word, we manage it. How can you manage something you cannot even understand? We're just discovering these things now. My stance is that we need to understand it more, more in depth, before we could possibly ever, ever manage it too. But by being members of Audubon, by being active in your community, by getting out and birding, you are kind of advancing yourselves and educating yourselves to make good choices in your life. And so I applaud you guys for even coming here tonight and say, hey, thanks for listening to me rant on about my crazy, my bird stuff there. If you got any questions, you can go to naturesmart.com. You can follow me on Facebook and Twitter too. And with that, I say thanks for coming tonight.